ice cream. Happy Halloween.
Well, this is, wait, it's my turn.
Oh, okay.
Okay. This is Bruce Friedman. The show is That's Brooklyn, but we're going to take you back to at least 1958, and there's a guy sitting next to me who was the reason that I got into television to begin with, okay? I had a friend, I still have a friend, named Jerry Zwiebet, and Jerry couldn't be here today, but Jerry got a statue, okay, a gold statue from the Walt Disney Company, thanking him for 45 years of service as an associate director at ABC Network Television. How did he get the job? Because he used to come down to Channel 7 to the basement to Studio B.
Yeah, there goes a boat down the river. This is very exciting. We're in the back seat of a car.
All right.
The cameraman is so torn around and he'll never be able to walk straight again. He's shooting between the two front seats and we're in the back seat.
You know, if you don't mind, I want to go back to WCAU in Philadelphia in 1957.
I want to get along with this fizz-biz here. Now, you understand about these things. You got to be real septic when you mix this stuff. I should be ready to start in a few minutes here. Just want to draw a little bit off. You got to taste the temperature, you know, just like a baby's bottle. You can't mess around with this racket of stuff. Feels rather good. No. It's not quite room temperature. Nice and sharp, though. Down here, you know, it's a little hard to get things at room temperature. The humidity, you know. Speaking of humidity, that reminds me of good old London. And always remember the day that Count Dracula landed in good old jolly England.
Writing this thing quite, and having attended the gala opening in the opera at Vasari last weekend, I decided that I would write my opera and get it over with. You know, I figured that the plot of an opera is not much worse than the plot of a movie, so if you can't lick them, join them, you know.
They're called the Shock Theater Group, Dracula, Frankenstein, the Son of Frankenstein, and all this. Bought that whole package. Somebody got the idea that they should have a person in charge who would lead into the film. And they remembered me because one day on the Cowboy Show 2 years before that, I had played an undertaker.
For this half hour of action in the afternoon.
Had a whole cast of people, horses, live horses. It was a live show. Didn't have any dead horses, of course. And shooting off blank pistols all over the place. And by the Monday, some stranger would come to town, and by Friday, he was chased out of town, or he married one of the girls, or he died or something, and a new, different person would come in to carry the story for the next week. And I thought there was going to be a tryout, but they wanted to give me this thing to be the host of these horror movies. And I had never seen a horror movie in my life because my parents didn't believe in those things being shown to kids. So every Saturday afternoon when all my friends went to the movies, I didn't go. Why, one day they had a meeting with the boss, whose name was, can't think of his name. It's not worth remembering, actually. It was Roland. I can still see him. He smoked the cigar. He couldn't get out. Roland. That's how it happened. And nobody dared to correct him. This one guy, boy, I wish I could remember his name. He's also dead. Everybody I know is dead. I know him, but who knows? He might not get up out of that chair.
Anybody.
But he said, you should come up to New York. You got a kinescope? And fortunately, I had a kinescope that somebody downtown in Philadelphia made by aiming a film camera at a television tube, which was very basic. And so I took that with me, and he took it up to introduce me.
You had an expression in New York, good night, whatever you are. Now, can you say that the way you used to say it?
Sure. Good night, whatever you are.
Now, where did you get that from?
I have no idea.
Well, I do. A guy named Jimmy Durante always
said... What did he say? How did he say?
Good night, Mrs. Calabash. Wherever you are.
Yes, there you go. That must have been it. Sure.
That was it. And you
never met him. I'd like to have met him. He was amazing.
Me too.
Guy.
He was amazing.
Wow.
Just great.
Yeah. Well, Jerry, I'm sorry about that. We kind of expected you, wherever you are.
Jerry and I, we met in high school, the first day of school ever.
Yeah.
And we were sitting on the gym floor in our gym suits, and they called it orientation. And we didn't know each other, we met. And there was a third guy sitting next to us, and his name was Gabe Kaplan.
Welcome back. Your dreams were your ticket out.
And who was the real star of Welcome Back, Cotter?
You got me.
John Travolta.
Oh my God, my God.
What's got a good beat but you can't dance to it? I give it a 35.
And he's supposed to get there like at 11:15 the latest, because the night show is coming on.
Oh my God.
And I'm exhausted, I'm so tired. And I get a soup bowl and I fill it with water, cold water, and I put ice cubes, and I get some potato chips, you know, and I get all ready, and I'm in my father's chair. You don't sit in my father's chair, even if he's not home.
Wow.
That's his chair. So I'm waiting for Jerry to come, and it's getting later and later, and the night show comes on, and Jerry's not there. And the announcer says, "Are your doors locked? Are your windows bolted? You know, welcome to the night show." And they're showing clips from Dracula, the Wolfman, Frankenstein.
Sure.
And all of a sudden, there's a rapping, a tapping on my living room window. And I turn around, and there's Jerry with a flashlight under his face. And he looks like Otto Kruger. And I was, he scared the hell out of me. And, you know, then we decided we're going to go down to Channel 7 to meet you.
Wow.
See, we walked right past the guard who was buried in the, you know, Daily News.
He was either reading it or he was asleep. Yes.
Asleep. And we ran downstairs, and you were expecting us because we had told Nancy Lincoln that we were from the Erasmus High School newsletter.
That's the name of the high school, yes.
Which was a lie. There was no such thing. So we got the appointment.
There wasn't Erasmus High School.
Yes,
huh?
But there was no newsletter.
Oh, okay.
Now, you come running down the hall in full costume with a wicker basket filled with cauliflowers without the leaves, which of course resemble
brains.
And we are, you know, like so nervous. Mr. Zacherley, and Lou Vopicelli, who is he? The director.
Yeah.
Sticks his head out of the control room and says, "John, we're on the air." And you said, wait a minute, I'm talking to the boys. Now you run into the studio, the show is live.
Yes.
And I forget his name, but the floor manager, Sal Balboa or something, he's going like this, 5, 4, 3. Jerry and I are like pogo sticks looking through the window of Studio B, and Jerry said, "Let's go in." And we walk in, and Bob Prescott, the sound effects man, he goes, "Shh." He looked like a walrus with this huge mustache, you know, with the handlebar and the eyebrows that came out bigger than Andy Rooney's eyebrows. Remember the eyebrows, Andy Rooney?
Yeah, yeah.
And he says, "Shh, stand behind," you know. And he's got this turntable, which has got three, you know, spinning discs.
Yeah.
One was Wolf Calls. One was Wild Cheers and Applause. And the other one was a baby crying.
Oh, my God.
Now, what did you do with the baby crying?
I have no idea.
Yes, you do. Who was your assistant?
Oh, Gasport?
Yes, and what was the sound effect?
I can't remember. Oh, yes. Oh, a moaning, yes.
But it was
That's all he did, he moaned, yes.
But it was a baby crying, slowed down from 78 RPM.
And that was Gasport who hung from
a meat hook.
A meat hook on a burlap bag.
Right.
And we couldn't afford to have live people, so that was the noise he made. I would hit the bag and shut up, I say, and he goes,
Now, we would come back every week, and you and the rest of the crew couldn't. How did they sneak in again? But one time, we went to your dressing room. Do you remember your dressing room?
Sure.
What did it look like?
In the basement, a long, long hallway where all the dressing rooms were, used for big shows like... Who was the guy that did the dancing show there? He's coming back now on commercials. He's a very religious guy, and he doesn't mind.
But in other words, what did you have in the dressing room?
What kind of stuff? All the stuff that people sent me, all crazy stuff.
Like a cow bone and a clock. A round clock that had a skeleton that popped out at you.
Oh, yeah.
You had all your makeup. What kind of makeup did you use?
Well, we didn't have a makeup person, and the guy in Philadelphia who dreamed up of cutting part of my hair in the middle and making sunken cheeks, you know, and had white, I'd pucker my lips, and he'd touch it with the white, and so when I'd open my lips, it looked like my lips were cracked. Mm-hmm. And that's about it, I guess. I don't know.
Well, no. How about your eyebrows? How did you get
the eyebrows? Were white, I guess, were they?
Yeah, but you used a bar of soap with a little water.
Oh,
and
yeah.
You pushed the bristles.
Them with the not too much water, so that it was like glue. You push them backwards, and they'd stay that way because of the stickiness of the soap, very dry soap.
Okay, but the day we came...
But they couldn't afford to have a makeup person come, so I had to do it myself.
But when we came to the dressing room, you were not wearing your regular outfit, okay? You were wearing a Victorian bathing suit that came to here and to your ankles, and you're sitting in a chair, and you've got clumps of hair, you know, phony hair that you buy in a makeup store, and you're gluing them onto your legs. And you're talking about, I want you to practice your swimming and your wolf calling over the summer, you know.
Oh, and, my God.
Okay. Now, here, see this? This is a sketch of you that I did, and I wrote up top, Chief Mumbler, John Zacherley. And it says here, well, I am a dada. See? Did you ever see the Dracula movies today? It's called Twilight. The very, very popular vampire movies.
Yeah.
Well, there's a huge success in Hollywood. And there's a girl who plays the lead vampire. Okay? In the movie, you know what her name is? Bella. Now, is that an accident? No, they wanted association with
Lugosi. Yeah,
sure. Lugosi.
Complain about it, but Dracula is the only picture in existence in all the world, which since it is revived, since it is made in 1931, it is the only picture which is revived in every city in America every year.
Well, you know, some people, Bella, would consider that a curse, and some would consider it a very good omen, because probably as a result of Dracula, you...
I make a living.
Never dreaming like this, loving somebody somewhere, keeping me blind while in love.
It's entitled Il Draculare. Thank you, my dear. Now, of course, the opera opens with Count Dracula pursuing the beautiful Princess Sananka. You understand? And she's visiting her uncle, Dr. Frankenstein. But Princess Sananka is secretly in love with Larry Talbot, younger brother. He goes under the name of Jack Milton. That's the way I worked it out. And Jack Milton has been unjustly accused, mind you, by the Internal Revenue Department. And he has become a troubadour. He has also just won the head-smashing contest in Versailles. Princess Sananka, running through the Malafasia Gardens in a diaphanous dress, off-white tulle, you know. Jack Milton in hot pursuit. So is Count Dracula. Now the two men meet, and they fight, and Dracula has his head smashed, and he sings a dark hymn of revenge, Non voglio giocare in vostra cortile. Tempo, my dear, tempo. I don't want to play in your yard, I don't like you anymore. You'll be sorry when you see me sliding down your cellar door. You can holler down my rain bar, you can climb my apple tree. I don't want to play in your yard if you won't be good to me.
This is water?
Absolutely. It's good water.
You're poisoned.
poison. And everyone I touch is poisoned. They die.
It's good water. You ever seen water like that? You know why?
Why?
It's from the Gowanus River.
Father was Frankenstein. That your mother was the lightning.
To strike terror into the hearts of men. To shock women into uncontrolled hysteria.
Elizabeth!
Now, Dr. Bludgeon is affiliated with the Institute of Lycanthropy.
Yes, we got a call from you people here in Brooklyn to come and check out where somebody claimed they seen a werewolf in your Prospect Park.
And the Wolfman, you know, is one of my favorites.
Listen to them, children of the night. What music they make.
I think I got hair on my throat.
Think of it, the brain of a dead man, waiting to live again in a body I made with my own hands. With my own hands.
Now I know his horrible plan. He's going to kill her and make her a living mummy like himself.
The jugular vein is severed. Not cut, but torn apart as though by powerful teeth.
A werewolf.
Do you believe in werewolves?
I won't have none of it, only because over there in London, for the past 10 years, I've been on the Council of Lycanthropy, so we found no evidence. Any association, not a scrap of evidence that we could say that there's any sort of thing as a werewolf.
And the effect of the full moon on a man could bring out these characteristics of the wolf. Are we talking about the beast, the dog-like creature, or are we talking about a man that, under the influence of the full moon, can change to a wolf?
It's a natural phenomenon, isn't it?
Friend?
How about a beer?
Another show. It was Joe Franklin's Memory Lane.
Yeah.
Now, I know you know Joe, and I spoke to him yesterday, and I said to him, Joe, you loaned me a DVD of a show that they taped some years ago of talk show hosts. He says, yeah, he says, I invented the talk show. I said, I agree with you.
From a cluttered office off Times Square, this man made a telephone call to a New York TV station.
I said, well, I'll consider it. I said, how about if I do a show of people talking, nose to nose, eyeball to eyeball? They said, Joe, you're out of your mind. The word is television. You got to give them vision. Got to give them cell survivals, pratfalls. Got to give them baggy pants.
Joe convinced the station's executives to let him try his show on TV.
Let's bring back Fran Lee, Mrs. Fix-It, ad-libber, unique. Here she is.
I think that day, in 1950, I invented or I created the talk show as we know it. It was just me on a sofa. I brought in the desk around 6 months later.
Joe evidently knew what he was doing because his local show stayed on the air for 43 years.
Something like 575 talk show hosts came and went during my tenure. Well, I'm in the Guinness Book of World Records for the world's longest running TV talk show, something like 28,000 episodes of the Joe Franklin Show. I saw a list recently of people who never did a talk show. I had them all, the ones that said Charlie Chaplin never did one. It said that John Wayne, it said Cary Grant never did one. I had them. I had 300,000 guests.
The Pat Boone Show,
yeah.
And he was a big fan.
Yes, he was, and he used to stop by my dressing room there, which was not far from his, and his show was done live, and they had a big audience come in, and he invited me to come in and say hello to the people and all that, and that was great fun. They had more people than they needed, and during the dress rehearsal, they would cut out something so it would fit into the one-hour show. But I was actually on his show once, and he just had me standing outside a window while he was sitting with his lady friend, and here's this window with rain dropping on it, and I'm standing there singing a song.
That's our ghoulish friend Zacherley. We managed to keep him out tonight, but he brought his own weather with him.
Count Dracula sleeps in his coffin all day. When night is descending, he goes out to play. Puts on his tuxedo, dress shirt underneath. Then he pulls out his nail file and sharpens his teeth.
A dinner was served for three at Dracula's house by the sea. The hors d'oeuvres were fine, but I choked on my wine when I learned that the main course was me.